The year is 2002. It's been 6 years since the release of Pocket Monsters Red and Green in Japan, and at this point, the Pokemon universe had been very well established. There were video games, TV shows, toys, and trading cards. Everyone knew about all the monsters and every aspect of catching, trading, and battling, so it's time for Game Freak and Nintendo to step it up a bit. There needs to be more to the Pokemon gaming experience, and more than that, there needed to be a new and different experience for new players, returning Pokemon Masters, and even those superfans who invested in both versions, Ruby and Sapphire. Not only was the overall gameplay experience improved with better visuals, new battle features, and a complete overhaul in music with a robust MIDI orchestra occupying your tiny cartridge, but there were also more opportunities to have a Pokemon adventure that was unique to everyone else around you. For instance, this was the first and only generation to have two different villainous teams for the separate versions, providing different challenges to players who had both games. And oddly enough, the opposing team will actually act as an allied force in whichever game you choose to play. Beyond this, new metadata of natures and abilities could change the outcomes of Pokemon breeding and make every wild Pokemon you came across a different and unique candidate for your team, despite being from the same species as so many others. Player choice has started to matter a lot more in the world of Pokemon, and while luck may still serve a purpose in catching the team you're working so hard to assemble, you also have the tools you need to play and customize your adventure in the way that best suits your own wishes. So, with new features throughout the game, from double battles to diving, and even arguably the greatest addition to the Pokemon series, running shoes, it's time we take a look at the Hoenn region and discover what's so great about Pokemon's third generation. Now that the Pokemon world had been developed over multiple forms of media, it became a lot easier to self-reference when further developing the lore of a new game. For instance, near the start of the Ruby and Sapphire versions, your character, and of course their parents, are mentioned to have just moved from Johto. This puts the players in the shoes of someone who's new to this region, and thus may know all about the Pokemon that have been discovered in previously covered regions, but has no clue what awaits them in the land of Hoenn. There is also some sort of precedent set with the fact that your father is an established gym leader. This player avatar actually has a slight backstory, unlike the previous games, but more comparable to your general RPG. In fact, with the knowledge in place of different types of people and jobs in the Pokemon world, new pieces of story can be added that deepen the experience one has while playing. For instance, it makes a lot of sense in this game why you and your rival match up the way you do. You're the child of a gym leader, and your rival is the child of a Pokemon professor, both proving your abilities to each other, your families, and yourselves. This also allows your competitive nature to be displayed in a less malicious way than the previous generations, with Brennan or May being your first rival in the Pokemon series with an actual positive attitude, and even a secondary rival in Wally, whom you help on his own journey. In fact, there's much more of a recurring cast of characters in this game overall. We haven't quite gotten to the multiple rival structure of the later installments in the series, but we have our main rival in either May or Brendan, then the recurring trainers of Wally and Steven, whom we can watch growing in their own respective ways through our encounters across our journey. It isn't just your friends and peers who have a deeper approach in this game, but your adversaries too. The enemies of this generation, i.e. Teams Magma and Aqua, are actually more intertwined with the storyline than Team Rocket was in the previous installments. Team Rocket always felt like a gang of evildoers who had nothing to do with you personally, but you just happened to stumble across them often enough to become a hindrance to them. Even then, they were generally out of the way by around the 6th gym or so, leaving no real antagonist for the later sections of the games. In Gen 3, however, you'll actually be incentivized to give chase to the villains, and the majority of your interactions with them take place while you're on your way to the 7th and 8th gyms. The plot of this generation is much more dramatic, with the goals of Team Aqua and Team Magma being much broader spectrum than Team Rocket's objectives were. Instead of a mafia-esque crime syndicate that snatches Pokemon, these two organizations are actually trying to physically change the world using powers beyond human control. This story doesn't feel as claustrophobically structured as your conflicts in the earlier games. The events of the story even affect the world outside your immediate vicinity. Depending on whether you're playing the Ruby or Sapphire version, awakening either game's ancient legendary Pokemon will cause the world to be stricken by drought-causing sunlight or torrential rain. This is visually noticeable upon returning to the surface of the overworld, and even shows up in battles, as well as in the environment of a few further away towns in the region. What really makes a game feel lively isn't just focus on the big story moments, though. Pokemon's third generation also has an enormous amount of general improvements to the game's overall experience. As far as I can recall, this is the first generation in which the other trainers and NPCs aren't entirely stationary around the world outside of towns. They look around, sometimes in the direction they know you'll pass their line of sight, and some will even be running back and forth or following a bit of a patrol route when either swimming or on a bicycle. The first few Pokemon games had a tiny bit of that, but it was really limited to quote-unquote cutscenes, rather than your fellow trainers having a feeling of being out and about until you cross their path. The land of Hoenn doesn't feel quite as geometric as the regions of Kanto and Johto. There are fewer long rectangular strips for routes and big squares for cities. A lot more of the world is interconnected, allowing for a lot of late-game pathways. To exemplify this to the player early on, the use of Mr. Briny's boat for early-game travel allows for quick transportation between towns, but also gives you a glimpse into the areas that you won't be able to explore freely until you come back with the ability to surf later on in the game. With the game's world being much larger than the previous installments, there are also much longer routes between towns or other major locations. Instead of filling these routes with labyrinthian caverns and slowing you down with endless wild Pokemon appearances, Game Freak instead filled these roads with many different kinds of trainers for you to battle against, and sometimes even sneak by if you were in a hurry. But providing the player with more challengers, optional or mandatory, greatly balanced the game in terms of needing to level up between plot points or gym matches. While playing through the third generation, I never really had to stop and go level up for an hour before continuing on my way, which definitely could be a part of your experience with the earlier Pokemon games. If you do feel the need to level up, you don't have to just run back and forth in a patch of grass, collecting minimal experience from wild Pokemon, but rather, you have the opportunity to both explore and train at the same time along expansive countryside roads and vast stretches of ocean where different types of trainers, wild Pokemon, items, and locales all await you. The biomes of the world fade into each other much more gradually. Even with the added colors of the second generation, early Pokemon games felt more like, here's where the land is, and here's where it stops and the water begins. But a region of Hoenn may fade from concrete paths to grass to sandy beaches and into a soft blue ocean. Different textures of grass, like in Verdanturf, show natural wear from foot traffic of the civilians and the routes they take when walking through the world. It makes Hoenn feel a little more lived in than the previous Pokemon games. There are even little visual touches like footprints in the sand and other little improvements which add to the liveliness of the world. The changes we see between the second and third generations of Pokemon, and more broadly speaking, the differences between playing on a Game Boy versus a Game Boy Advance, are probably due to the biggest technological jump in the Pokemon series outside of the transition from 2D to 3D gameplay. Comparable to our discussions in the Legend of Zelda Link to the Past video, this was as big a graphical jump as transitioning from the NES to Super Nintendo. The technology was no longer beholden to three-color sprites and plain overworld palettes, so both the Pokemon and the world around them were given the chance to flourish in turn. When coming across them, possibly in towns, Pokemon in the overworld actually look like their in-battle counterparts. Each type of trainer also has their own sprite in the overworld, rather than a much more selective base of options to represent multiple types of people. In a similar vein, each Pokemon now has a personalized icon in your party menu, no longer being categorized into vague Pokemon monster types. More effects of nature, both visually and mechanically, are seen in battles such as sunlight and sandstorms, including ones that come directly from the overworld rather than through the use of moves in battle. In fact, this was a significant enough change to the meta of battles that a whole new Pokemon, Cast Form, was added just to take advantage of these changes and additions. In terms of gameplay, Game Freak finally had the processing power to add in a few more features that they had supposedly been trying to include for multiple entries at this point. Otherwise, there were just plenty of new additions that added a lot more depth to the competitive battle scene. Every Pokemon now has an ability, or rather, a few possible abilities that may allow for the same Pokemon to be used in tandem with completely different strategies for different players. On top of this more obviously explained change was the addition of natures in Pokemon. While not explicitly described in-game, natures will vary any Pokemon's unique stats by 10% up or down, such as a timid Pokemon having higher speed but lower attack, and a relaxed Pokemon having lower speed but higher defense. There are also a few more interesting combinations of types, or changes to the way type differences are managed through Pokemon abilities. Like Kecleon changing its type depending on what it's attacked by with the Color Change ability, Sableye having the first appearance of a Ghost Dark type which negates all super effective attacks, or in a similar fashion, the Pokemon Shedinja having the ability of Wonder Guard that means it will only take damage from super effective attacks. The Pokénav was a significant improvement over the Pokégear in Gen 2, and finding trainers who want to rebattle is no longer limited to the selective few phone numbers you can collect, or furthermore, waiting on said few trainers to call you and let you know they'll be waiting on whichever random route you encountered them on several hours of gameplay ago. Now, there's just a big list of trainers who you can easily predict which types of Pokémon they'll have by name and design, and you can have your pick of the lot in terms of who you may want to train against. Pokemon contests offered a totally unique experience for Pokemon trainers out there who don't want to only use their Pokemon pals for fighting and training. Instead, players can utilize the skills of their Pokemon, as well as the vastly deepened gameplay mechanics of breeding and berry planting, to compete in several aspects, such as having the coolest or cutest Pokemon. Several cities have different contest locations, giving a creative, comparable experience to pursuing each gym badge. Given the fact that the contest scene was also a major plot point of the Pokemon anime being released at the same time, it's easy to say that this was another great addition to the Pokemon universe that allowed players to be the Pokemon master that they wanted to be, no matter what that may mean to them. When creating a sequel, developers have to toe a fine line between maintaining the familiar aspects that longtime fans have come to enjoy and find reliably comfortable, and changing things up to either entice new players to join the fray, or keep those who may have grown tired of the old formula. Game Freak made it obvious that this generation was going to be big, and it was going to be brand new. To really drive home the point of how new and different everything is, upon starting your adventure, you won't see a familiar Pokemon for quite some time. Instead, you're justifiably thrown into a fresh world with exciting discoveries to be made. In fact, if you happen to spend enough time in a cave or other area with wild Pokemon, you'll hear their cries in the distance, as if they're hiding nearby. The Pokemon world we know and love is more colorful than ever, in every sense of the term. And every little choice you make, from which bike you rent and where you build your secret base, all aids in making this your adventure, not a single straight line that you're meant to follow from one end to the other. With the inclusion of plenty of new metadata additions and changes to the Pokemon experience, players who wanted a deep dive into trading, breeding, and overall knowledge of the Pokemon world now had something far more in-depth to spend their time on. But on the other end of things, players who don't care about all the technical mumbo-jumbo behind the scenes aren't in any way required to focus on it, and don't even have to know what EVs and IVs are or how they work. The same old Pokemon formula is still there to enjoy, but with new improvements in matters of aesthetics, gameplay, and overall player experience. That is what's so great about Pokemon's third generation. Thank you all for joining us on this episode of What's So Great About Gaming, as we ventured into the Hoenn region of Pokemon's third generation. Make sure to tell us what you think about Pokemon Gen 3, or even suggest a game for another video. If you want to hear what's great about another game, check out the link to our last episode, Super Mario Brothers, on screen or in the description. And please take the time to subscribe to be involved in the discussions here. Thanks again for watching. Now go play a great game. We'll see you next time.